so very much. This morning I've talked to you about this generation needs vision. And without vision, people perish. Thank you. This would be a good time to turn your phone off. That's what I did. So be a good time to turn it off instead of playing with it when I'm trying to speak to you. But that's all right. I'm getting over it. I'm not bitter. But this generation needs a vision. Without a vision, the people will perish. If we don't have a vision, we're just lost. I was talking to, how many know there's a grocery store in Cornwall? Barry Streetman is the owner of that grocery store. His grandfather started that grocery store, then his father ran it until his father passed away, and then now Barry has. It's been there since 1931. In Kanawha, America. And I was talking to Barry the other day, or yesterday actually, and he was telling me, there was a young lady that was working for him that just moved to another job. She actually went to work at the clinic, and she was working in the office. It's a long story, and I just wanted to show this with you. You'll get it in a minute. She was working in the office, and as a youth pastor for a lot of years, and now pastor for a few years, you notice signs of things. And she had these straight lines cut on her arm. And I said, "Heather, what are you doing?" "Nothing." I said, "Let me see your arm." And she said, "Why?" Because she knew I knew. I said, "What are you doing?" "I'm just going through a lot of stuff." She's 19 years old. "I'm just going through a lot of stuff, Jeff." I'm not Brother Jeff, I'm Tortilla Jeff. And so, I said, "What do you mean you're going through a lot of stuff? You're 19 years old. Why is it so bad?" And she talks about a relationship and some things that were going on, some stuff, some private stuff that doesn't matter. She said, "Those are the good ones. Let me show you these." And she had a pair of pants on that had a hole right here, and they were just these big, deep cuts in her leg. And they look like, you know, when they heal and they have, look like a worm. Because they're raised up scars. And she had just done, they were pretty fresh. And I said, "Heather, baby, there's nothing that bad that you got to cut." So I gave her a card for the church and I gave her my phone. I told Naomi, I said, "The girl Heather calls, that's what it's about." And, you know, hey, I already ride with a lady, much less have her call my house, okay? And so, that's what this is about. If she calls, this is who this is, and she just needs something. Because I told her, "Do not cut yourself. Call me. Call me anytime. I don't care what time of the day it is. Call me." I say all that to say this. In the conversation with her, it's all about right now. There's no vision for the future. It's all about right now. Her boyfriend and her are having hard time problems, so I have to cut myself. And I'm like, "Babe," I said, "you're 19 years old, I'm 45. Let me tell you, it gets better. It gets better. I promise you it gets better. I'm 26 years older than you. I'm 26 years wiser than you. I'm telling you it gets better." But as a youth pastor forever and a pastor for a little while, I know the signs. And she just stood at the office window and just wept. I said, "Get yourself into a church that will help you in Ottawa. If not, drive down here." And the reason I say that is this, because the generation that we're looking at right now has no vision. It's all about right now. It's all about being pleased right now. It's all about everything happening right now. There's nothing to look forward to. What am I going to look forward to? Get out of college and be unemployed. What is it to look forward to? To spend 4 years and $150,000 on college. And now I'm $150,000 in debt because I took out a student loan. And now Sally Mae's calling. They want their money back. And I deferred it as long as I could. I still haven't paid any interest. So now I owe $250,000. And so they look to that, and their job market is bleak. Their families are destroyed. And there's just not any vision about anything to do with this. They're just like, okay, so it's all about now. And when it's all about now, you wonder why there's such a drug and alcohol problem. When it's all about now, it's very easy to fall back into the drug and alcohol scene because it makes you feel better now. Well, hallelujah.
Amen.
It makes you feel better for today. Regardless what it does to your future, it makes you feel better for today. It's easy to go out and get drunk and forget about your problems. It's easy to go get high and not care about your problems. But the problem is, once you sober up and come down, your problems are still there, and you still have to find another way to deal with them. But this generation is calling out for something that is real.
Amen.
You guys get with me today. I know there's opposition. I'm praying for you. I know there's opposition toward me. That's fine. I've got big shoulders, and I got four men in the office that pray for me today, and I believe in their prayers. This generation is calling out for something that's real. I'm not about something that's phony. I am not. This is who I am, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. This is who I am. I am not somebody else. Brother David went with me Friday to work. He said, "I'm going to go work with you." I said, "Whatever." No, I don't know why, but he did. And so he went with me. And this is how I am. Okay. Testimony. David is my proof. Well, I don't believe anything David says. I don't care. Anyway, and so. But he's my proof. This is who I am. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. This is me. I'm just real. I'm not phony, fake. This, you don't have the church Jesus and the outside of church Jeff. That's not what you have. You have church Jeff and outside church Jeff.
Right.
I just have. That's who it is. I don't have any other agenda. I have what God has placed in my heart to do. That is my agenda. That's why I'm a borderline workaholic. Probably am a workaholic, but I'm a borderline workaholic because when you have passion for something, sleep gets in the way. Truth. When you have passion to do something, sleep is something that's wasting 8 hours, 6 hours, 4 hours of my day. I left here at 2 o'clock. I got back here at 15 till 9 this morning. I slept for 4 hours and I couldn't go to sleep because I had something to go. I had something in my mind. I had this message rolling through my spirit. I've got a church that is bordering on greatness, but I got some that choose to not be great, some that choose that don't know how to be great, some that don't want to be great, some that wish they could be great, and I've got that. I'm juggling that. Because I want you to understand, this church is bordering on exploded. I told you, I don't know if you understand that. I told you a year ago, we can either implode or explode. It's up to you. I told you a year ago, we can either implode or explode. But it's up to you. What do you want to do? Listen, I told the guys in the meeting this morning, I have a deacons and elders meeting every morning. I love it. Every Sunday morning, I'm getting to know them. They're getting to know my heart. They understand where they're coming from. Hopefully they're understanding where I'm coming from. I told them this morning, I can't preach what I preach and then live another life. I can't preach what I preach and then live a different outside. I cannot just read the scripture and say, well, that's what it says, but I'm going to do this. I can't do that. And if you want somebody to do that, then I'm not him. I will do what this says, and I will do it to the best of my ability. Okay, not only, listen. They're looking for something that is real, something that calls to their spirits. But they need something that will get started. Listen, I don't know about you, but how many remember? Come on, help me this morning. I'm an audience participation preacher. You got to help me every now and then. Listen, how many remember when you got saved and nobody had to tell you you got saved? Do you remember? When nobody had to say, oh, well, you just got saved. I knew I got saved. I was clean from the inside out, lye soaked and everything. I was ready. Now, most of the young people, lye soap. My grandmother used to make lye soap, put it in aluminum pie pans. And they cut it up in squares. And this, it would, if you weren't used to it, it'd take all the hide off your hands and stuff. True? Dirt and skin and everything is off. Clean. But hear me this morning. Hear me this morning. I want you to misunderstand what I'm saying. When I got saved, I got saved. Yeah. I didn't walk up to the altar and say, well, did I get saved? I don't know. Yes, you got. Listen, I knew when I got here and I got up from here, I was different than when I came down here. Is there not that possibility anymore? Is that a thing of the past? Is that gone by the wayside? I don't know. Because all I know is this, is that they need something that this generation is calling somebody that will say, give me something that's real. I need something that's real. Don't tell me about it. Show it to me. They need something. A generation needs vision. And without a vision, that generation will perish. Right. We're now in the third generation that knows nothing of God. 40-year-old grandmother has a 20-year-old daughter who has a brand new baby, and they've never been in a church house. They've never heard the story. They never have darkened a church door. All they've ever seen is the infighting of church. They say, I don't want church. All they've ever seen is the unforgiveness of church, and they say, I don't want church. All they've ever seen is people getting hurt in the church, and they say, I don't want church. All they've ever seen is a preacher get on TV and try to rip people out of money. They say, I don't want nothing to do with church. And you gotta tell you this morning, it's not about church. It's about a relationship and having your spirit change. It's about having something different in your life. It's about being clean from the inside out to where you don't want to sin. Not that you don't have to. You simply don't want to. Maybe that's something that's crazy now to talk about. I don't know. But hear me this morning. Whenever you get something that's real inside of you, you will change your actions. You will change the outside appearance. No one will have to tell you how to dress. You will know how to dress. No one will have to tell you not to cuss. The cuss will get taken out of you. No one will have to tell you to put the drink down because the drink won't taste any good anymore. No one will have to tell you not to roll the dope because you don't want the dope anymore because you are high on Jesus. I don't know if I'm helping anybody today or not, but I'm making myself happy. Listen, something has got to call into their very spirits. Something's got to change. Somebody has to have a vision to reach a generation for Jesus Christ. Somebody's got to have a vision to not only take it this generation, but mold it with the other generations. Listen, young people, you need the older people. Older people, you need the younger people. Middle-aged people, you need both sides. Because you don't know. Listen, I understand. They have this perception that, those young people, it is awful. And you may be right. They may be crazy. This may be the lunatic you're looking for. But you have to understand something. They are looking for the same thing you were looking for. Something that is real. The only problem, the only difference is, when I went to church, Mama took me to church. Now it's Mama sends them to church. We feed them. We clothe them. We give them everything that's in us. I have them for an hour and a half on Wednesday, and the world has them for the rest of the time. And the people look at the church and say, why didn't you fix my kid? Because the home is broken, and they have no vision for tomorrow. It's all about right now, self-gratification. What can I do right now? A girlfriend's not a perspective. What is that word? That's it. Wife. She said, maybe I can get lucky. Vice versa as well. You're not looking to have a future. You're looking for right now. And after that, if that offends you, then you got more issues I can deal with today. But hear me. This generation that looks me in the face every Wednesday, and they love Brother Jeff because Brother Jeff loves them. And they run up to me and hug me. And they find me and they love me because Brother Jeff loves them. And I want the very best for them. I don't want them to ever hurt. My children I absolutely adore. My children are the most important kids in this church to me. Gasp and swoon. They are. They're mine. They are mine. I love you ladies, but I don't love you like I love my mother and my wife.
Right.
Hear me?
Yeah.
I love them and I adore them. They are the most important and precious to me. But underneath that line, that right there, underneath that, every one of those kids that come in this church and they darken this church door, God has given me a soul to win. God has given me a life to change. God has given me a destiny to set forth. God has given me somebody that he's entrusted me with to say, go and teach them how to be disciples. I look at every one of them the same way. They are potential soul winning world changers. They are. I don't care if they're the biggest hoodlum in the place. Peter was a big hoodlum. Walked with Jesus 3.5 years, was packing a blade. Don't tell me! Cut the man's ear off. Was walking with Jesus and didn't want to pray with Jesus for 3 hours. Didn't want to pray an hour. But as soon as it got tight, see, cut the guy's ear off. Don't tell me he wasn't a hoodlum. Brought a knife to church every service. Not only listen to me this morning, that's the first two lines. Listen to me this morning. Not only for their peace of mind are they looking for something real, but for their very souls. You don't think, listen, we think the kids are stupid. They're not stupid. They're not stupid. They know there's something out there. This is that hole that you had in your life. They've gotten theirs. Jesus births you with that hole that only he can fill. How many have ever heard that?
Amen.
He births you with that hole that only he can fill. And they are trying to fill it with video games and with all this junk. Listen, the devil has us so busy. Right now it's killing some of you that you can't get on your phone and text somebody or check Facebook. Right now you're about to die. You're trying to.
Yeah.
Will he notice? I will notice. I won't say anything, but I'll notice. It's about to eat your lunch that you can't check your phone. Really? We can't wait an hour, 45 minutes to check. Listen, nobody's that important. If they didn't get hold of you, they'll get hold of you, I promise you. Listen, not only for the peace of mind, but also for their very souls. Listen, someone to carry them and to call. Someone to carry them a call for a living God. They need somebody that, listen, not some cold religious set of rules that no person can follow, but they need something real. I don't know about you. I'm trying to calm down and talk to you for a minute. I don't know about you this morning. And I don't know how you came to Jesus. But I dare say, most folks in this church that got saved and are still living for the Lord, you went to a church that didn't care about hurting you out and hurting that crowd in 45 minutes. I dare say, most folks who are still living for the Lord that are my age, they had a church that had church.
That's right, amen.
They had a church that let God do what God wanted to do while God wanted to do it. Amen. They had a church that would get at the pastor would say, ain't nothing I can do, and walk off and let the Holy Ghost just move. I need to get out of the way and not try to preach every service and let God just have his way. I guarantee you, most folks that are still saved today and have a calling on their life and an anointing on their life, most of those folks went to a church that had Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, or Thursday night, one of the two. I guarantee you they didn't go to what we have that is popular now. And I'm not saying, please, I'm not criticizing. I'm not. I'm just stating a fact that these are the people that I talk to that are my age, that I know, that I not only grew up with, but kind of know growing up, that most are not in the little cookie cutter 45 minute bless me service and out. It is to let God do what God's going to do and then bask in the afterglow for another 30 minutes. We don't even know what that means anymore, do we? That means once you get done praying, you sit there and just go, God, thank you, just weep and cry. And then God just moves in this place, and it's just such a sweet presence of the Lord. Does anybody even know what I'm talking about? Amen. Y'all look at me sometimes like, where did you grow up? I grew up right here. Right here. Right here? I grew up right here. Okay. Listen. We have that call. What call? We have the call to take this gospel to every generation, not just the young, not just the middle-aged, and not just the old, but every generation needs to have the same anointing. They need to have the same call in their life. Listen, I have that call. What is that call? To take this gospel to this generation and to the generations that are here. I have that call, and I'm trying to get it into this church. I'm trying to get you to understand what our business is. Our business is not your agenda. Our business is not your position. Our business is not that at all. Our business is to be a soul-changing place where people can come and get life soaked up and changed in an instant. That is our business. I have that calling on my life. We have that calling. Listen, to be the one to reach this generation and connect it to our past generations. We cannot just say, well, I'm going to win this generation and leave it there. Because if we do, then we miss out on the middle-aged generation and the older generation. That is not my aim. I am not aimed to shoot at Abby's generation, and that's it. I've got to reach Buddy's generation. I've got to reach my generation. I've got to reach my mom and dad's generation. I've got to reach my sister. I've got to reach all that age group. I've got to reach them. For if I don't, then I fail. I failed this. Listen, I can't just be a single generation preacher that says, young people are it. No, young people are great. And I love them. And a church must have young people to have life in it. And if you don't believe that, go to one that doesn't have any. And it's a morgue. I don't mean to talk bad about anybody. And my God in heaven, if you don't have life, go find someplace where there is some. I'm just telling you, why would you want to go to a place where you never get a fresh word? Where God's never speaking to the pastor, preacher, Sunday school teacher. It's just repetitive. Why would you want to go someplace like that when you could come to a church and get, I'm not trying to drag you out of anybody's church. That's not my point. My point is this. Why not get a fresh word from God every service? I'm just asking. I'm not Mr. Wonderful, and I'm not the best preacher in the world. I'm not, but this is what I am. I'm passionate about what I'm doing. I seek God for what's going on. I try to live what I preach to the best of my ability. I know that messes some of y'all up, but I still try to live what I preach. I do. I try to be the best I can be. I try to be the best pastor I can be. I want to pastor a great church. And to pastor a great church, you got to be a great pastor. And I'm getting there. And I'm trying my very hardest. But I have that call to take this generation to the kingdom of God, to the generations, and make a complete body of Christ instead of just a piece of the body of Christ. It is not my call to make one piece of the body of Christ. That's not my calling. My call is to make a complete body of Christ that I can present it to Jesus and say, man, here's your bride. And that's what my goal and my aim is. Not to just be, well, here's part of it. I don't want him to remove my candlestick. I don't want him to take my talents and give it to the one that has in it. Everything, because I was afraid and I dug down and I hid my talent. Take that one from him and give it to the one that has the 10. I don't want mine taken away. I want to be busy doing what God's called me to do. I want to be busy having the things of God alive in this church. I want to be busy doing what God has called us to do. Listen, I preached for the last 30 months. For the last 30 months. That it is not us against them. It is us for them. I am not a... Listen. I'm opposed to the devil. I'm not opposed to sinners. Oh, boy, that went over great. I'm opposed to the enemy of God. I am not opposed to those who are lost in sin. Even those, here, watch, I'm about to cuss, those homosexuals. day. Well, they were cheating on their wife. I couldn't talk to them. They're not in my prayer circle. They're not my friend on Facebook. I couldn't talk to them. I had to block them. There's nothing wrong with blocking people. I have to block some people because God just gets out of the trash. There's nothing wrong with that. I choose what I put in here.
Amen.
You don't choose for me what I put in here. I choose what I put in here. You don't tell me what I want to hear, what I want to see, you know, what I want to say. You don't tell me. I'm in control of this. And I'm in control of this, and I'm in control of these, and I'm in control of this. Okay? What's in the power of the tongue? Life and death. You choose. Life and death. Hallelujah. Man. It's a good thing we didn't have congregationals. Okay, here we go. I preached for 30 months. That it's not us against them, but it's us for them. We have a responsibility to our neighbors, to our families, to tell them, to show them, and to love them into the kingdom of God.
Amen.
I have a responsibility. Who is my neighbor? What did Jesus say? Thank you. I'll read a scripture in a minute, so y'all don't panic, okay? This is all, I'm telling you, this is where we're at, right here. Right here. I've got four pages. This is where we're at. So y'all just buckle in. Okay? We have a responsibility to my neighbor, to my family. Not only to tell them about Jesus, anybody can tell them about Jesus. I'm talking about showing them about Jesus.
Amen.
I don't want to hear your words. This generation can care less about your words. They want to know what your actions are. Oh, I'm sure. Never mind. Show them and love them into the kingdom of God. If you have your Bible, turn to Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 2. Habakkuk, that's in the clean part of your Bible. That's the Old Testament. I never read the mind of prophets. The Lord answered me and said, write the vision. Make it plain upon tables. That he may run and readeth it. I don't know how to make it any more plain, so I wrote it down. Here we go. You guys ready? I want to be a church that brings flawed, broken people to Jesus to be healed in all aspects of their lives. To be the hands and feet of the Lord to meet the needs of his people physically, emotionally, and spiritually. To be a church of families caring for families no matter what condition we find them. To stand in the gap for people no matter their social or economic status. You ever got that? I want to be a church that brings flawed, broken people to Jesus to be healed in all aspects of their lives. Hit your neighbor and say, he's talking about me. That was weak. I am talking about you. And I'm talking about me. Touch your neighbor on their arm and say, he's talking about us. Thank you. I want to be a church that brings flawed. Oh, I have no flaws, liar. Broken, I'm not broken, liar. I'm not broken. I guarantee there's something in your life broken. I guarantee you have a flaw. There's something that's not perfectly going on with you. To Jesus. I want to bring you to Jesus to be healed. We think his stripes on his back were just for our physical healing. That wasn't it, only. When you're emotionally broken, when you're emotionally destroyed, he can fix you. When you've been sexually abused, he can heal you. I'm trying, brother. To the hands and feet of the Lord to meet the needs of his people. Not only physically, I can feed you, but I can't heal you. I can clothe you, but I can't change your life. I can give you hope, but I can't be the hope maker. I can tell you where hope comes from, but I can't bring you, I can't give you hope in your life. I can just bring it to you. Okay, does that make sense? I emotionally, I can get you to the altar. Spiritually, I can get you to the altar. To be a church of families. And that's what a church really is. Families in a family. That's what a church is. That's why churches are so jacked up now. Because the families are so messed up. I remember going, I was talking to Mr. Streetman yesterday. When I came to church, when I was a kid, it was mom, dad, and the four kids came. Not so much anymore. Now, we're blessed in this church that we have a lot of that. But it's not so much that anymore. It's more of, y'all need to go to church. But mom, why don't you go with me? I went to church when I was a kid. You need to go. It's not so much that anymore. A church of families, caring for families, no matter what condition we find them. Now, trying to find a place I can stop in there. When I say that, you guys look at me and go, amen.
Amen.
Okay? When I say that we're a family of families and take care of them no matter what condition we're in, everybody always says,
amen.
Amen.
Okay? But do you know what that means? Do you know what that means? I mean, when you say amen to that, you're saying, I will do it. So be it. So when we have families that come in, and the dad is a drug addict, the mother has been beaten up, the kids don't know when to stand up or sit down, they don't know what to do, they've never been in church in their life, and I get that look, you need to do something with those kids. And I get that look, what are they doing? When I hear through the grapevine, he needs to do something about that. And I'm going to go back to you and say, you remember when I preached this? And you said,
amen.
I'm just going to remind you that you're the one that said, amen. I didn't make you say amen. How many control this? Amen. But it's my desire to have a church that cares for families. Cares for families. Cares for families. And no matter what condition we find them, if we find them, the Lord has brought them our way. But I don't know how to deal with a drug addict. I don't either. But God does. I don't know how to handle two women being married to each other and they bring their children. I don't either. I don't know how to handle two dads bringing their son. I don't know how to do that. Oh, that's never going to happen. What America do you live in? Well, that'll never happen in Seminole. Really? I feel that that's very plain what I said, that everyone should be able to understand what vision I'm trying to impart into this body. There's enough churches that are just having church. Well, glory. How many say that? We still love Brother Jeff. God didn't mean that. All right. I feel that it's very plain that there's enough churches just having them. Please don't walk out and say, he ran out every church in this city. I did not. They are wonderful people. I love them. My calling is not their calling. My vision is not their vision. What God has given me is not for them. It's for me and for you.
Amen.
It's for me to share it with you that we can go fulfill what God has placed in my heart. That's simply what it is. It's not my will to go say, okay, brother, go along. You got to do what I said.
Right.
No, because God has a vision for the First Assembly that's different than for mine.
Right.
Brother Marvin, you got to do what I say. No, Brother Marvin has a different vision for First Baptist than what I have for the Pentecostal Church of God. It's a different vision. It's a different mindset. But the whole thing better be about winning souls for the kingdom of God. Because I don't know about you, but Brother Tim Tate, his vision is different than mine at IFC than it is at Temple of Praise. It's different because, listen, God gave him a calling and a vision for those people that are sitting under his voice. And whether you like me, hate me, are mad at me, don't like me, love me, whatever, but God has placed you here for a reason to hear this vision for this body. And if you can handle it, great. If you can't, great. But this is what God has given me for you. Listen, it's not easy to follow. Matthew chapter 9. Verse 10 through 13, and I'm trying to hurry up. Got a visitor standing up. This guy preaches for 2 hours. I try not to. I could. Don't think I couldn't do it. And it came to pass. As Jesus said at meeting in the house, behold, many publicans and sinners came and sat down with him and his disciples. Verse 11. And the Pharisees, who the church folks saw it, and they said to the disciples, why eateth your master with publicans and sinners? Verse 12. And then Jesus heard that he said to them, that they that be holy, not a physician, but they that are sick.
Right.
We know it.
Yes.
But we don't want to deal with it. Verse 13. Thank you. 13. Thank you. But go ye and I learn what it meaneth. I will have mercy and not sacrifice, for I am not come that they to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. I am not called, I'm not here to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance. How dare you allow that person to do anything in the house of God? I'm not called to win you. You're supposed to already be saved. I'm called to win somebody that doesn't know anything about the Lord. I'm not called to win your favorite person and your little pet that's already, that you know and you love. I'm not called to win them. They're already won. I'm called to that one that stinks like alcohol. Smells like dope. Has needle marks up and down their arms. Maybe I'm in the wrong place. I don't know. But hear me, that's how do I do that? I don't know. I don't know how to do that. But that's just what the calling of God is in my life, to reach the wretched, the sick and disgusted, the flat busted, those that don't have any hope, and drag them to an altar and say, this is the answer. The wealthy and the middle class who have no hope. They have plenty, they have money, they have plenty in their house, but their house is divided, their marriage is in trouble, the very walls of this kingdom they built for themselves, they're crumbling, and you have to say to them, but Jesus can change your life and put your marriage back together. Those people are just as important as the alcoholic and drug addict. Those people who feel like the church, they fall between the cracks of the church because they act like they've got it all together. But when you get down to the nitty and the gritty, their families are in turmoil. They have children who are crazy. They have a husband who's running around on the wife, or a wife that's running around on the husband because they're looking for something to fill the gap, something to fill the hole. Something to feel, make me feel like somebody cares about me. And all they're looking for is somebody in this body of believers who will stand up and not be intimidated, will not blink an eye, will not apologize, but say, listen, Jesus is the answer for your problem.
Amen.
Ah, dear God in heaven, I want to be a church like that.
Yes,
it's not easy. It's not an easy vision. It goes against everything in us not to retreat into our church and hide until Jesus comes.
Amen.
Oh, you can look at me and say, oh, me or amen, whichever. Well, can I have 15 more minutes?
Yes, I can.
30.
tell me that the other hour. And I have 15 more minutes, and I'll finish it later tonight. But it's easy to retreat into our churches and hide out till Jesus comes. It's easy to come to the house of God because I'm saved and my family's here. I can fill it. I can fill up my pew with people. My wife's aunt is here, and her brother and my sister-in-law and my niece and nephew are here. My wife's grandmother is here. James and Shirley are here, who I absolutely love and adore. And I got Mark and Doris, they're all here. It's very comfortable. And if I start naming names, everybody's going to be mad at me. But, you know, we got Norma and James, and we got Scotty here, and familiar brother Dean's here. And we got Jim and Wanda. We got a familiar family, and it's nice. My mother and father are here, and I'm so grateful to still have them at my age, to still have my mother and father both. And I'm so thankful that it's easy to just retreat into the church and say, Jesus, I thank you for my blessings, and I'm just going to hang out in the church. But that's not what Jesus has called me to do.
Right.
He didn't say, get saved and go to church.
Right.
He said, get saved and go make disciples. He didn't say, just get saved and hang out till I come. He said, occupy while I am gone until I come.
Amen.
To occupy means I make a homestead. I get ready to be there a while. I dig a well. I build a home. I'm occupying. I don't occupy the place that God has called me. It's easy to retreat into our church and hide until Jesus comes. But that is not what I was called to do. And that was not what I was called to do. It. I was called to lead a revival in the last today. That's what I was called to do. I was not called to hide in the shadows and only come out in the noonday sun when the sun is shining brightly and there's no darkness. That's not what I was called to do. It's easy to come outside when the sun's shining brightly and there's no shadows and you can see everything that's around you. But when you step out in the dark,
come on.
When you step out in the dark, you don't know what's around the corner. You have to trust God. You have to trust what He's doing. You have to trust that you hear His voice. You have to trust that you're His sheep. You have to trust because I can hear His voice and I know my Master's voice. I don't get confused. I know the voice of God and I know the voice of the enemy. I know His voice because He's awesome to me and He's called my name. Listen, I call Him Jesus. He calls me Jeff. And I'm just telling you, I know His name. Listen, I was called into this place to lead an army into the dark places of this world. That's what I'm here for. I'm not here to make you feel good. I'm not here to make you. I'm here to call an army to the dark places of this world. A group of people who think more of others than the new dress or new shoes.
Amen.
And there's nothing wrong with a new dress and new shoes. I would to God that you get new dress and new shoes every service. Don't bother me a lick. But hear me. But here's where I want to get to, and now I'm going to stop. And I'll finish the rest tonight. When we are more bound by this, I can't, because I want to buy something for myself, I can't give into the kingdom of God. Because if I give into the kingdom of God, somebody else will be wearing my shoes because they're on sale. Somebody else will be wearing my suit because they're on sale. And we know there's a world out there that said, guys, I don't have time to go there this morning. Listen to me this morning. There are more needs to be met than we're meeting. There are more people that need things than we're meeting. Listen, understand my heart. I'm not wanting you to take advantage of. I'm not telling you to sell your home and give all your money to the poor. I didn't tell you to do that. Don't you walk out of here and say, Brother Jesse, we can't have nothing. I didn't say that. What I said is you ought to be a blessing. And to be a blessing, you got to be blessed.
Right.
You can believe it or not believe it. And I can't give somebody, I had a whole $15 cash in my wallet. I can't give somebody $15 if I don't have $15, and I'm always needing $15.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. I got to have it in my wallet to give it.
Yeah.
Okay. I was called to lead people who understand the church is not about hiding in the sanctuary, but being on the battleground, face to face with the enemy. Face to face with the enemy, not flinching and not falling prey to his weapons. Okay. Man. Where can I stop? Can I read you one more scripture now? Ephesians chapter 6. I'll read one more and I'll quit. Ephesians chapter 6, verse something other. 12 and 13. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 and 13. There we go. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world. Against spiritual wickedness in high places. Keep reading. Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. It's not an easy calling. The calling that God has on my life is not an easy calling. I know that. I understand that. The calling that God has on this church is not an easy calling. You were not called to be eased into the kingdom of God.
That's right, amen.
You were called to be an army.
Come on, that's good.
Taking people with you into the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Winning enemy held territory and taking it back from the kingdom of God. That's what we were called to do. Without question, the devil is looking to destroy all that you've ever had or all that you've ever known. That's what he's looking for. He comes to you relentlessly until you feel like giving up. He does not want you to defeat. He does not want you defeated. He wants you dead.
Right. Yeah.
Understand that. How many of you have ever watched the cartoon The Incredibles? Okay. You can tell I have kids. Okay. Every movie I ever talked about is about a cartoon. There's a scene in that movie where the mom has Dash and... what's our daughter's name? Violet. So mom has Dash and Violet, and they just found out they have these powers or whatever. And they're hiding in the cave. And she said, you know the shows where, the mom says it's the kids, you know the shows where they don't, where the evil people don't kill the kids? These are not these people. They will kill you and not think about it. Let me tell you something. If you think for a second the devil will not kill you because you've been in church all your life, you have lost your ever-loving mind. He will kill you, walk over your dead corpse, and not even think twice about it. He will kill your marriage. He will kill your money. He will kill your family. He will kill everything in your life. He will destroy you and not think one second and not lose 1 minute's sleep, not think, oh, I shouldn't have done that. He is evil. And he is evil personified. He is evil. He will kill you and not care anything about what he did to your life.
Right.
And if you think that he has any remorse for anything that's ever happened in your life, you are kidding yourself. He absolutely detests, hates your guts. He cannot, I don't know if I can say it any better than that. He cannot stand the very breath that you breathe. He hates it. If you exhale, he said, that stinks because it smells like a child of God. He cannot stand you. He hates you, despises you, cannot wait till you are a dead corpse and your soul is lost and in hell. That's where he wants you. So if you think for a second he will not take your life and mess it up, this calling that is not for the timid. He comes at you relentlessly. He wants you dead, backslidden, unable to fight him because you're too busy fighting among yourselves to fight him.
Amen.
This is our time. This is our time.
Amen.
This is our city.
Right.
This is our opportunity. It's now time to take over some enemy-held territory, to take advancement into the kingdoms of darkness and retrieve a few souls back into the kingdom of God. It's our time.
Amen.
I'm not done. I'm stopping. You can get the rest of it tonight. Everybody's twitching and moving, okay? I don't want anybody falling out the window and breaking their neck. Okay? Hear me for just a second. I don't want to talk about Jesus like he's not in the room.
Amen.
I don't want to talk about him like he's not here. This is not his eulogy. He's awesome, and I'll read over the rest of it later. But understand where I am, church. This church has a destiny, and it has a purpose. And if you want to be part of it, come on. And if you don't, stay where you're at. Stay where you've been for the last few years. But God has a purpose and a destiny for this place.
Amen.
Brother Jeff, you're just crazy. Yeah. I'm possessed. The Holy Ghost is possessed.
Amen.
I've got vision.
Amen.
I've got passion. And I'm not about ready. Let Buster's family, or my family, or Kelly's family, or Joey's family be lost.
Amen.
And not at least throw up a stop sign and say, wait a minute. Wait a minute. What about this Jesus? I said last week, and I said again this week, I'm not a preacher who preaches in types and shadows. It's Jesus in your face, and then you have to deal with him.
Right.
Had somebody tell me, I don't remember who it was, or if I start calling names, I'll tell the wrong person. But they said, I never had anybody tell me in church, there's some stuff in your life you're going to have to deal with it. And head on deal with it. There's some stuff in our lives we're going to have to deal with. Hurts, disappointments, anger. We have to deal with it. And Jesus will make you deal with it. You choose. You choose to deal with it or not. You choose how you deal with it. You choose either to deal with it and repent of it and make it right, or you choose to sweep it back under the carpet and let it fester for another year and a half. It's how you deal with it. It's up to you. All I can do is present Jesus to you. Put him in your face and make you deal with him. That's all I can do. Would you bow your head with me this morning? If you're in this place this morning, first of all, I want to thank you for coming in and obeying the Lord and coming to church this morning. If you're in this place and you don't know this Jesus that I'm talking to you about, you need to know him. He's the only answer to every problem that you ever had and ever going to have. He is the answer. He's not going to take you and take you out of your problem, most likely. He's going to walk with you through your problem and get you through your problem. But you are not alone. If you accept him as your Savior, you are not alone. But if you refuse him, you have to walk by yourself and you have to deal with things by yourself. And I promise you, it'll be a lot harder to walk without him. He is the answer for your question. He's the answer for your problem. If you're here in this building, you say, Brother Jeff, I don't know this Jesus. Who is he? What can he do? If you raise your hand and say, Brother Jeff, please pray with me. Please pray for me. Amen. Okay, you can look up. 3 services in a row, I've made the same plea, and nobody has raised a hand, and I know it's not true. How many weeks do you think you have? Do not take this place for granted. Do not take the anointing of God for granted. You don't come to God whenever you want to. You come when the Spirit draws you. 3 weeks in a row I've made the plea. 3. See, the devil just tells you this. You got plenty of time. What he's telling you is, man, you got plenty of time. Oh, yeah? The 20-year-old lady coming from Avoca, you got hit by the truck. She thought she had plenty of time, I'm sure. I don't know if she's saved or not. I don't know, but I'm sure she had her life planned out more than being 20 years old. And I've heard people have miscarriages and they lose babies. I'm sure they had plans. They had nurseries ready. They didn't mean for the baby to die. The plan wasn't for the baby to die. They didn't have plenty of time. 3 weeks. How many more weeks until God gets hold of you and hooks you and draws you back into the kingdom of God? Is it worth the feeling of pride? Is it worth the feeling of I'm right and they're wrong? Is it worth that? Is it really, is your eternal soul spending eternity in hell, burning forever and ever? Is it really worth being right? It's up to you. And I think if you really dig deep down, you know that you probably are right, but that wall you put up and that hatred you put up is wrong. That unforgiveness and that inability to forgive, unwillingness, that's the wrong thing. Not what they did to you, that you did anything wrong, no. But that wall of discontent, that wall of anger, that's got to come down. Do you understand you can't be what God's called you to be as long as you continue to live hurt? That's another sermon for another time. You can't live and be what God's called you to be as long as you live your life being hurt. Let Him heal you. Let Him move upon you. Let Him touch your life. Let Him restore you. For if you're not restored, you'll always walk hurt, damaged. Let Him restore you. God, all I can do this morning, I've preached as much as I can preach, and I've preached my voice out, and I'm tired, and I'm telling you, I gave birth to this baby today. I had my legs, and I had, you know, they got the salad spoons out and everything. We got it done, okay? I was breathing, doing my mom's breathing, everything, okay? That thing's done. Come back tonight, you'll get another one. We'll have twins a few hours apart. But hear me this morning. Hear me. I love you so very much. Some of you I don't even know, but in the kindred spirit of the Lord, I love you. And I want you to understand that. And I'm not... And please don't ever walk out of this place and say, Brother Jeff, he talks bad about other churches. I don't. Now, that was just an example. So I told you, I've made it very clear. Made it very, very clear. Their vision is different than mine. Doesn't mean they're wrong. It's just a different vision.